We all know that question, what comes first, the chicken or the egg? And we can argue that all day. But when it comes to GERD, what comes first, the GERD or the coughing?
Find out today on Medical History Mysteries.
Everybody, welcome to another Medical History Mysteries. This week we're talking about GERD and coughing. What comes first? Tom, hit me.
Well, I never knew this was an issue. Honestly, in all the time I had been working in medicine, I had heard about it, I had thought about it. It kind of made sense, but no one ever really was able to prove it. But over the last 5 years or so, I'm starting to see more and more, not just anecdotal evidence, but actual evidence I can point to in patients that I've seen. So tell me what's going on here. When you have acid reflux, you've got this extra acid, right? That's refluxing up into your esophagus. If it gets high enough into your esophagus, where it gets into, your pharynx, it's going to make you cough. And people do this in their sleep. They cough from that burning sensation they have in their throat. So they're just trying in their sleep or maybe half asleep to clear their throat. What I've learned also from GERD is that sometimes it's not just acid, but mucus that builds up, which is your body's natural way of trying to buffer that acid that's in your throat. So you've got this combination of mucus, maybe from postnasal drip, or maybe just from an excess production of mucus, because you're getting the burn from the acid. You've got the acid. The combination of the two makes you cough. Okay, so when you cough, what happens? Now, you're asleep or half asleep, you breathe in, and you breathe in some of that acid, some of that mucus. And if you've got periodontal disease or something else going on, you're breathing in some of that bacteria as well, all of that being aspirated into your lungs, which irritates your lungs. And can be the result or the cause, really, of other respiratory conditions that you might have. So all of a sudden, we're starting to realize, wait a minute, is GERD the cause of respiratory disease? Is the GERD causing the cough, which causes you to aspirate all of these things, so acid, mucus, and bacteria? It's possible. Many people have been diagnosed with such things. But now turn this around. What if you have respiratory disease and you cough a lot? Well, if you cough a lot, right, you're coughing up all of these secretions into your throat. And so I can't say that that's a cause of GERD, but I can say that that can be enough if you swallow enough of those secretions to upset your stomach enough that maybe that is a cause for reflux, because some people end up getting reflux from eating the wrong foods, swallowing things they shouldn't. They get this stomach upset, and it's a natural reflux according to some people that when you cough, you relax certain sphincters that may allow now acid that would ordinarily reflux up into your esophagus to reflux. Again, I can't point to any one article or journal article or peer-reviewed study that said that's definitely the cause. But it's this chicken and egg thing that you and I like to talk about because it opens up the thinking to, well, let me see the next time I've got a patient with GERD or respiratory disease, let me ask about either or and find out if there is a connection.
It's interesting that you say that. It makes me think about a patient that was a longtime patient of a practice that I was a hygienist in back in the day. And the patient always had this tendency to clear their throat. This just like a clear their throat. And it turned out they ended up with pharyngeal cancer. And they were, and they felt like that was initially triggered by GERD. And so I think that when patients come in with anything that's abnormal, like a chronic cough or something like that, I know sometimes we get scared thinking maybe they've got TB or an actual, specific respiratory illness, but maybe they're just being irritated by something else that's underlying.
I agree. And I think, when a patient has GERD, they may not even know they have it. Sometimes it's us. Sometimes we're the first to tell them they have it. We see the damage to the enamel, damage to the salivary glands, the varices in the back of their throat. I mean, we see the obvious signs of GERD before they even do. But here's the other thing, if they've got GERD and they're coughing and they end up with this constant cough, It may not necessarily be a cough. It just may be, as you said, this clearing of the throat, constant, like sort of, I call them half coughs. Like you just kind of go and you're just clearing your throat. But I do know Barrett's esophagus exists. I do know that when cells are under constant attack by acid, they undergo metamorphosis. And when they do that, they become precancerous. So maybe it's not just the esophagus, maybe it is the pharynx. This is where dentistry matters because if you start to see the signs of GERD, you're thinking, what else do I need to warn this patient about based on my knowledge base of what could result from this? And let's not forget that these days, anyway, what you're looking at may not even be GERD. It might be cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome, where people are using large doses of THC, they vomit a lot, and that, maybe they don't, maybe they vomit right before they go to bed, and that acid is still in there, and that's burning, and that makes them cough in their sleep. So I've got to be the Sherlock Holmes here and figure out, okay, this is what I see. Now let's extrapolate and see what other potential complications there could be.
I love this because I feel like this is the quintessential oral systemic connection that we've got such a profound opportunity as a dental professional to create a deeper relationship with our patients and
Absolutely.
also impact their lives in such a positive way. And so I think we have to talk about at least certain mechanisms of tooth wear. You see on occlusal surfaces of molars, sometimes we see those little raspberry seed catching divots in the occlusion
Yep.
of the tooth. Let me tell you cannot grind that pattern in no matter what, caliber grinder you are. So sometimes we see this and we think maybe the patient's grinding. You can only get those pits in the occlusal surfaces of the teeth on the cusp tips like that through acid and specifically clenching. You cannot grind that in place.
That's
And
right.
we also might notice that patients, their incisal edges are starting to become friable and you can see through them and they're starting to look thin and unsupported. That is an early sign of wear. And so are you grinding that in place or are you seeing more signs of acid wear? And I think that we don't give acid the respect that is due.
Couldn't agree more based on the foods that people enjoy, based on the lifestyle that they choose and nutritional choices that they make. But let's face it, Pam, the bottom line is if you tell your patient this, many times when I say this in my live lectures, people come up to me afterwards and say, sounds great, Viola, but it's pie in the sky. I don't have time to do this. I barely have time to eat lunch. And you want me to have a full-blown conversation about the patient's health? I'm an expert in teeth. That's about it. And that's how they think. And so if I say anything, they're not going to listen to me. And I always say the opposite, which is no, the fact is that you did mention it. It makes them think, why would my dentist or hygienist mention that? They have no skin in the game. Obviously, it must be important. Let me go get this checked out. And that's the benefit that dentistry provides to a patient. That's the value of your words. And we should never underestimate the value of those words because they make a patient's and a difference in a patient's life. And they're going to love you forever. They're going to say, that dentist, that hygienist told me about that. No one else ever mentioned that to me. I'm going to stick with them forever.
Absolutely. And hygienists, if you're noticing this out there, go before, grab the dentist before they walk in for the periodic exam. Mention it because sometimes when we're both sending the same message, that will compel a patient to go get it checked out.
Great.
So together, everyone achieves more. And again, don't lose sight of the amazing ability that we have to change people's lives. I think being a dental professional has never been more exciting than it is right now. And I think patients understand that there is an oral systemic link, and it's just our job to, connect the dots for them in their specific health condition. So get out there, do great things, and, let's get our patients healthy.
Absolutely. Rising tides raise all boats, right? So that's how I look at it. Let's work together as a team.
That's right. All right, everybody, for Medical History Mysteries, we will see you all next week.
Take care, everybody.